Justice Venkatachalaya, ladies and gentlemen, I would just like to run through the basic compelling ideas and premises of my book. It will help you to understand what it contains and possibly leave you with a lot of questions. It's not a solution. In life, there are no solutions. There are no right answers. There are no wrong answers. Many of the issues I have raised, like, for example, the role of the armed forces in the 21st century, this is an alternative point of view, and there are other alternative points of view also which we need to debate and we need to discuss. I think Justice Venkatachalaya so eloquently put it across, the basic, I would say, the foundation of this book is based on the innate goodness of man. Despite all the violence which history has seen, all the turbulence we are seeing in the world today, man is good. If man is not good, it makes a bloody nonsense of whatever God you believe in, or whatever religion you believe in, or whatever values you believe in. Our very existence here is proof of the fact that man is good. And contrary to popular perception, I think one of the most erudite scholars of this world, Steven Pinker, his whole hypothesis is now scientifically accepted, that the 20th century has seen the decline of violence. In fact, if you go back into history, 20th century appears to be a very non-violent century that man has seen. And it also brings out, this book, is the negativity of alienation. I think this is a fact which we in India are dealing with today. And I have often said this, that the opposite of life is not death, it is indifference. Likewise, the opposite of love is not hate, it is indifference. When a man becomes indifferent, that is violence, that is dissent. That is the new shape and form of dissent. And I recall when Nelson Mandela walked out of Robben Island, and people were running after him, the media was there, and they asked him that, 27 years you've been incarcerated in these prisons over here, do you not hate these people who put you over here? And he said something very profound, and that is the theme which runs through this book. Where was the time to hate? How beautiful, how beautiful. Where was the time to hate? And the very people who were his perpetrators, when he was sworn in as the president of South Africa, they sat next to him, his prison guards. He said, you sit with me. That is truth, that is reconciliation. Ladies and gentlemen, this book is not about Sadbhavna. Sadbhavna is an inspiration. I have extrapolated ideas and strategies from Sadbhavna. And I waited 12 years to publish this book to see whether some or all of these strategies would bring peace or not. For the last 12 years, Ladakh is a zone of peace. No infiltration, no caches of arms, no clashes between the Buddhists and the Muslims, and peace reigns over there. Because we were attempting to do something which had not been done before. This was a great socio-political experiment, and it was very essential for me to wait and to see whether the thing worked or not. Now, the first premise, and I've given a small little handout to all of you to sort of jog your memory. The first premise is that peace is everybody's business. Each one of us in this room is a citizen, and our responsibility as citizen is peace. It is not the exclusive role of the government of the day, or the public sector, or the private sector. It is everybody's role and responsibility. We are citizens first, diplomat second, doctor second, soldier second. We are citizens first. And therefore, as citizens, governance is our responsibility and peace is our responsibility. In a flat, complex and interconnected world with growing economic insecurities, government by itself cannot manage everything. Even day-to-day chores of governance, our governments today are finding it extremely difficult to manage. And therefore, this notion of governance being that exclusive right of government, I feel in a flat world that we live in today, is no longer relevant. And everybody is responsible. The social sector is responsible for it. NGOs, private sector, business houses, armed forces, judiciary, media. Isn't media an institution of state, the fourth estate? Isn't judiciary an institution of the state? How can media and judiciary or even the armed forces say that we are not part of governance? We are part of governance. Whereas we have our functional roles to perform, but I think overall we should not lose sight that we are responsible for it. In some cases, I feel the non-governmental agencies, not NGOs in a narrow sense, but everybody else, they could take the lead, they could take the initiative, they could either partner the government over there. And in certain cases, which are remote areas, which are inaccessible areas, or sensitive areas, I feel they need to piggyback the local administration. That is what we did in Sadbhavna. We piggybacked the administration. After all, if the house is burning, if people have no food, if snows have not melted, there is no water over there, can we turn around and say, listen, this is not our bloody responsibility, we are not citizens, there is a DC, there is an SP over here, there is a tehsildar, go to him, why are you coming to me? That is now how citizens respond. And I think that is the essence of the first premise that I speak about. And this book, the second part of this premise, the subset of this premise is that when we embark on such a mission, ladies and gentlemen, there are 100 people who will try and dissuade you. And they will say, this is not going to work. Because basically, we have become so pessimistic in life that, you know, anybody tries to attempt to do something, we give him 100 reasons why it can't be done. Let me tell you, the biggest lesson which history teaches us is that we never learn from history. History tells us that it takes one Messiah and 12 apostles to bring a new religion into this planet. It is 1% people who transform society. The 99% are silent spectators. It is this 1% who bring about change and who bring about the goodness of man. And my question to all of you in this room is, are you part of that 1%? I think we need to seriously go back and ask ourselves this question, am I a part of that 1% or am I part of 99%? I think the second premise is that while violence has come down, the typical violence, the World War I, the World War II, the Vietnam or the Prussian War type violence has come down over there, I think because of sustainability problems, because of empowerment issues, because of social equity issues over there, there is a rise in protests and dissents. And as you are all aware, that the Times person, the Time magazine person of 2011 was the protester. The protester was declared as the man, the Time man of 2011. And if you look at the story of the Arab Springs, if you look at the Occupy movements that are taking place, if you look at what is happening in our country today, the push against corruption, whether they are succeeding or they are not succeeding, that's a different matter over there. But there is a swell of dissent and protest and alienation that is taking place over here. And there is a new thing which is coming about, and I talk about this in the book also. It is called horizontalism. This is a new word in the dictionary, in the lexicon, horizontalism. And I think the best example of horizontalism is from democracy. A democracy is representative democracy, like we have. We have representatives who represent us. We have participative democracy, where we enter into a dialogue, we go to vote, we exercise our franchise. And the third type of democracy is the city-state, this Greek city-state democracy. It's called direct democracy. What the Occupy movements are saying, What the Arab Springs are saying is, we do not know what we want, but we know what we don't want. We don't want to be represented by our people in parliaments and Lok Sabhas and Vidhan Sabhas. We want to talk to you directly. We want to ask you some questions. We want to hear you. And this is a new movement which I think has started, and we need to give weightage to. And of course, I think a big challenge for leaders in the 21st century is going to be, is this last bullet which I have shown over here, is that leaders must learn how to encourage dissent and how to manage dissent. Dissent is not to say, I couldn't care a damn. Dissent is not to burn buses. Dissent to say, Daddy, I will do what you're asking me to do, but I do not agree what you're asking me to do. That is dissent. That is intellectual dissent. There are 5 compelling ideas. In this hall over here, we've got some very eminent generals of the armed forces over here. And I will take off from where Justice Venkatachalaiya said, when the Kaurav and the Pandav armies were arrayed against each other and Arjun was dithering, Lord Krishna said to him something very profound. He said, the aim of war is not to kill, although killing may be necessary. Killing cannot become Clausewitzian. Killing cannot become an objective. When killing becomes an objective, then we go back to barbaric days. And I feel this is a minority opinion. This is a very minority opinion which I am voicing, is that in the 21st century, where war as an institution is getting outdated because of the interconnectivity of the world, because of globalization, because of the need to have legitimacy. A country cannot go to war without legitimacy. Because of the human costs, the material costs of war, war is itself becoming very outdated today, especially in the context of India, Pakistan and China, which are nuclear states. And therefore, war as a solution today, I feel, is an unthinkable solution over here. Therefore, this book argues that the role of the armed forces is no longer to win war. It is to prevent war. And how we prevent war? Well, you'll have to read my book about it, or we could discuss it. The second compelling idea is about what is national security. National security is not the sum total of guns and tanks. National security to me is human security. If the people of a country are not secure, national security is not in place. I think at the core of this is human security. If people in a country are unsafe, if minorities in a country are unsafe, if the poor people of this country have nothing to look forward to, if the aspirations of the people are not being addressed over there, that is human insecurity. And as long as human security lasts, national security will not be in place. And in my experience, and I'm sure the other generals over here in the audience would have experienced similar things over here, that the military derives its strength from the people of its country. The day the people of a country withdraw their support for the armed forces shall fail. Vietnam is a living example of what I have said over here. It's very important that when we talk of winning the hearts and minds of people, it is not only the hearts and minds of people to solve political problems and social problems. The armed forces can only do well externally or internally if the people are with us. It's very, very important to garner the support of people. We got a very eminent economist, when Professor Rao, over here, and I think he will, I'm not too sure whether he is going to argue against this point which I'm going to make right now, but I think the important thing is that I'm reminded of what Robert Kennedy once said, and I'll come back to this. Whenever we have a problem in India, or whenever we have a problem in Africa, our answer is, set up more hospitals, give them more airports, give them roads, give them schools, give them strong governance over there, and we hope that the problem will get wished away. Ladies and gentlemen, this is a myth. Those strategic planners who think that by throwing money away and by constructing roads and bridges and hospitals and this and that, and giving them governance and giving them growth and giving them GDP and giving them GNP is going to resolve the problem, they need to review this whole thinking. The Arab Springs is a living example that this thinking does not work. And Robert Kennedy often said that the GNP measures everything. GNP measures everything except what makes life worth living. And ladies and gentlemen, I think we as leaders in society need to look beyond economic definitions of progress, happiness, and peace. We need to look beyond. GDP must translate into happiness of a society. If GDP does not translate into happiness of society, it's not worth it. We need to work more on it. Winning the hearts and minds of people is a shibboleth. You cannot win the mind of the people unless you win the heart of the people. Heart is about trust. If the people don't trust you, they will not trust all the intellectual arguments that you're putting out. All this great philosophy that we are churning out is of no avail. You have to win the hearts first. The heart, the mind is like mathematics. It tells you how to go. The heart tells you where to go. And I think this is something which the armed forces in our country have not clearly understood. Even armed forces in most countries have not understood that winning the hearts and minds, you cannot win the mind of people till you win their hearts first. You have to win their trust first. And trust cannot be won by logic alone. This book talks a lot about women's empowerment. And I feel that women by nature are non-confrontationalist. I don't know how many husbands in this room will agree to that. Women abhor violence. They're always at the receiving end of violence. And if you empower women, you improve their quality of life and society. They are the true stormtroopers of peace. And of course, education. I need not tell you that education is of course one of the most powerful tools to bring about this thing, to bring about change in society. So in this book I've offered some ideas. We don't have to necessarily agree with it, but I think if we can generate some discussion on it, we can force us to rethink, to re-examine it from a different angle, different perspective, in a different light, I think my purpose would have been served. And with these, sir, I hand you back to these very two eminent discussants over here, who I'm sure are going to ask a lot of issues. I would just finally close by saying that whether we are CEOs of companies, whether we are commanding officers of units, we are heading hospitals or whatever business we are doing over there, we have to look at the aspirations of human beings. You cannot buy silence of the people. You cannot buy silence of the people for long. And I think this aspiration of people for freedom, for democracy, to intellectually dissent, to say, I will do what you are saying, but I don't agree with what you are asking me to do. Unrestricted access to knowledge and free expression, I feel, is more important than just going in for GDP and GDP alone. Thank you very much.